In Navajo, we're told stories of where we came from. In our traditional tellings, we believe that we emerged from the middle of the earth. The beginning of time was the black world, then there was the blue world, and the yellow world, and the white world. And now we're in the glittering world, where things are made of many things and many colors. At the beginning of the fifth world, the first man and first woman were created and given their gender identity. Things that came from the earth were used to make the differences between them. For the woman, a kauri shell was used to create the vagina, and for the man, the penis was created out of turquoise. In the Navajo world, everything has a gender. The high peaked mountains are masculine and the low rolling hills are feminine. The holy people said men and women must be kept in balance, and this also applies to the physical world. It's very important to know where we come from, because at the end, we always return here.
Societies. Men and women had well-defined roles. Men were responsible for hunting game that would feed members of the tribe. They also participated in warfare. Women were responsible for caring for the children, taking care of the village, and providing other types of food to members of the tribe. A two-spirited individual combined these roles.
A person is really a person whose gender identity is not what we would consider the norm. We wouldn't consider a male, all-male gender identity or an all-female gender identity, but somebody who really encompasses both, that have some male attributes, that have some female attributes, and are able to carry those roles on into society. It was a little bit more respected in traditional societies to have somebody that's able to do both of that, to be able to walk in both worlds, so to speak, to be able to live in in a male body and dress as a female, or live in a female body and dress as a male, and be able to really kind of cross those boundaries. It'd be easier for people really to identify as two-spirited, because it encompasses a lot more than sexuality. It encompasses the political, it encompasses the spiritual, the social, the psychological. I think to say two-spirited is a much more holistic approach than to just limit one's gender identity, gay, straight, male, female, whatever.
I can only sort of repeat the stories that I have heard from those who identify as two-spirit, and it is very... it is a term that is filled with all kinds of meaning. And so I do want to say that there are a huge group of Native Americans who are GLTB who do not like the term two-spirit. So I want to lay that out. And part of that is that the ones who generally do not like it, before I say what it means to be two-spirit, are those who come from tribal communities that already have words, terminology for their alternative genders. So those are the ones who generally don't like it. And then also there are a group, particularly Navajos, who don't like it because of the way in which they engage the idea that there are two spirits. To have two spirits would mean that there is something wrong with you, that you'd have to have ceremony. So that the Navajos generally, most of them, the majority that I have met, do not like the term at all. They're really quite opposed to it. It's all about identity, and people will take their identities and the terms and labels, make it fit for themselves or not. What it means to be two-spirit is, it comes from, the term is really looking at someone who has both a, the spirit of the male and the female. And so they carry that with them, and there is a sense of pride of being able to be a two-spirit bodied person. They had individual names, whether they were Winkti, whether they were Nadale, and so there were certain names in which tribes called these alternative genders. So that's way at the beginning. That incorporates tribal history. And generally, they were accepted in their community. Some were considered to have, special powers. Not all. They were, as long as they were doing their job, they were, considered a human being and a viable member. So when Christianity came over, that's where it sort of all changed, because Christianity is embedded in the idea of male and female and what those roles are and what those activities that are attached to them should be. And so that's when it really became, there became a change in tribal communities, because what happened is that many Native Americans had turned to Christianity. Or syncretic ways of worship, meaning that they practice their traditional ways along with Christianity. But some of that idea of that this kind of behavior was unacceptable, inhuman, you know, began to filter into Indian communities. And, you know, homophobia is well and alive today still in tribal communities. So the treatment of them at that point was pretty negative by many. And then there became a change. GLTB people started to, natives who considered themselves GLTB, were the ones who basically lived in the city or that lived in tribal communities that didn't, that history of the names of which they called them had been lost. But many GLTB people, really a lot of them moved off the reservation and went into cities. And they pretty much took on this terminology of the day, which is gay, lesbian, transgender, bisexual, GLTB. You know, it was a place where they could be themselves. You know, they were isolated or ostracized from their community sometimes in the early days. And so they'd go out into the cities, but it never was fulfilling. There was something missing in the GLTB, you know, community for them. And so this was part of that drive to sort of find this identity that fits you and your culture in a way that is comfortable for you as who you are and where you come from. And it wasn't until there was a meeting they were trying to create a name for themselves. They didn't really like GLTB per se, and they were really fighting, which was the derogatory term of burdash. Basically, it was a negative term for who these people were and who they saw themselves to be and their place in society. It was like this, it was this imposed identity upon them. And so they really took back their identity at some point, and they came up with the term Two-Spirit. It really is a term that is a contemporary term. It's a term that basically mainly urban natives use. And it's been pretty acceptable, and it's in contradiction, or it's in opposition, basically, not contradiction, an opposition to this imposed kind of terminology that has been placed upon them. They are very, very in the forefront of really trying to bring back traditional histories for themselves, because they find it both empowering and important for survival. And so it's an interesting and unique combination of both looking at your traditional history and trying to find it and work with people in your community to bring it back, and at the same time, you know, working within this kind of contemporary identity, which is, it's becoming huge now, of being what is considered Two-Spirit. They're not idly, you know, just living their lives. They're advocating and they're activists. And it's really growing. I think the movement is growing quite large, and I'm glad to see that. But I'd have to say that it's probably tied to the national tenor. I mean, it's tied to sort of where we are in America and where we're going, you know, with both marriage equality and really, I think that we have changed. America has changed in a way that's more accepting, and so I think that that's probably why also the momentum is gaining speed as well. So there's this understanding of the land, living with the land, and also tied into a sense of obligation and responsibility. It is not America where you are an individual out for your own. there is a strong sense of taking care of everything around you, and that is land, water, for the next generation. And that is not an American way of living. You know, I want mine, I want it now, and I'm gonna, if I use it up, I don't give a shit. So I think that that is what will distinguish those who identify as Two-Spirit, because they have this sense of history with the land and with place that is tied to a responsibility and an obligation in the world in which you live. So the Two-Spirit identity incorporates elements of this responsibility, appreciation, and understanding of the land, and the obligation and responsibility of engaging in ceremonies. And so there are some ceremonies that whether they go home for ceremony or whether they do urban ceremonies with Two-Spirit, you know. So that is the clear distinction between the two.